WYFF News 4, live local breaking news at 6.
Evening, everyone. I'm Michael Cogley.
And I'm Carol Goldsmith. Thousands of people use it every day, but starting next week, those people will not be able to cross the bridge on Rocky Creek Road in Greenville County.
In fact, it's going to be off limits for months. News 4's Gabrielle Komorowski joins us now with the story. Gabby, how many months are we talking about here?
About 4 months, Michael, at least until the end of June. The State Department of Transportation needs to tear down the old bridge and put up a new one.
This bridge over Rocky Creek Road is a part of Greenville County.
I wish they had done it earlier, though.
That Kayla Cutshall is very familiar with.
Well, I actually drive this road probably about, I drive it about 3 o'clock in the morning to take my husband to work.
But soon, that early morning drive will have to be on another route for Kayla and for the estimated 10,000 others who travel over this bridge right outside of Simpsonville each day. The State Department of Transportation is closing the bridge on March 9th. Workers have already started moving the gas lines. Kayla doesn't like what she sees.
Well, I was kind of upset about it because it's going to be another good 15-minute drive just to get him to work in the mornings.
Part of the bridge was damaged by large logs late last year. It was repaired, but the Department of Transportation decided that the bridge, which was built back in 1963, needed to be replaced.
It'll be completely torn down and a new bridge put back.
Brandon Wilson with the State Department of Transportation says that drivers will be detoured onto West Georgia Road. The detour also uses Fork Shoals Road, New Harrison Bridge Road, and Fairview Road.
It's a little over 11 miles long, and it's about 6 miles longer than if you were to use Rocky Creek Road and drive straight through.
Wilson is asking drivers to be patient.
Yeah, we're trying to make it as safe as we can.
The condition's pretty bad, so I mean, it would probably be a good idea to change it out, but just hope it don't take a while.
Kayla will have to wait a few months. The new bridge is expected to be up around June 28th.
The project is expected to cost the state between $300,000 and $350,000. Again, the bridge on Rocky Creek Road closes a week from today on March 9th. Back to you.
All right, Gabby, thank you. Well, it is official tonight. It was a tornado that caused the damage Monday night in Travelers Rest. That twister knocked down power lines and trees. No one got hurt, but there is some property damage.
News 4 Chief Meteorologist John Sesrich is here. And John, this thing was proof that even a fairly weak tornado is not weak at all.
No, not at all. It still had 80-mile-per-hour winds. But, you know, I've been talking about this for years, Carol and Michael. In fact, most of the time we usually get straight-line winds or microburst, and they are just as strong as most of the tornadoes that do occur here on average in the south. They're not huge, and they're not very strong tornadoes. So it causes just as much damage, a microburst of straight line winds or a tornado. It's about the same, and especially in this case. You can see that line just after 5 o'clock on Monday evening. The tornado touched down 6 miles north of Travelers Rest and had 80-mile-per-hour winds. The path, it was about a little bit over a mile long on the ground, and the width was about 60 yards. Also, the National Weather Service out of the JSP National Airport confirmed that around 96, just east of the town of Greenwood in Greenwood County, that was a microburst straight-line winds, which had winds of 60 to 70 miles per hour. So it caused just as much damage as this tornado that touched down just 6 miles north of Travelers Rest. Quite a line of thunderstorms that marched across the area. Another storm system on the way for us as we head toward the weekend. We'll talk more in detail about that a little bit later on. Now back to you, Carol.
John, thank you. A Greer subdivision woke up to a hail of gunfire and a tense standoff. Police say they were called to the Bent Creek subdivision in Greer around midnight in reference to a domestic situation. When officers approached the house on Marcy Rush Lane, they say the man inside opened fire. The SWAT team moved in and officers returned fire. Police won't say how many shots were fired, but we are told no one was shot. As a precaution, several nearby homes were forced to evacuate.
There was continuous gunfire. I mean, there might have been a break of 10 minutes or so with no shots, but for the 2 hours, it was just kind of scary.
Gregory Cleveland is charged with attempted murder and discharging a firearm within city limits. More charges are expected to be filed.
Tonight we have learned the cause of death for a man who was found yesterday afternoon along some railroad tracks in Oconee County. The autopsy this morning showed that Michael Jerome Reed died from a pulmonary embolism. That's an obstruction of a major artery in the lungs. He was 43 years old. The coroner tells us Reed had been living near those tracks on Lindsay Road, where his body was found yesterday afternoon. No signs of trauma on the body, but there were signs, we're told, that Reed had been exposed to Monday's severe weather.
Police in Spartanburg need your help tonight identifying a thief they say used someone else's credit card to spend thousands of dollars. Public Safety gave us this video from Best Buy on Spartanburg's west side. It shows a woman who investigators say used a stolen credit card to buy more than $3,100 worth of merchandise. The video is from February 11th. And according to an incident report, the Sears MasterCard was stolen in Greenville. If you recognize the woman in the video, please call Spartanburg Public Safety. Drugs stolen from assisted living. And tonight, Spartanburg County deputies say an employee is to blame. Now Myrtle Pearson is charged with theft of a controlled substance. Deputies say the theft happened yesterday at Rosewood Assisted Living in Pauline. The director there noticed some Lortab was missing from the narcotics drawer. According to deputies, surveillance video shows Pearson taking the Lortab and putting it into her purse. Pearson is out of jail tonight on a $5,000 bond.
The Asheville police tonight have a warning out about a texting scam. According to police, several people this week said they received a text message that their account at the Telco Credit Union had been suspended. It asked that they call back and verify account details. Now, the police say banks generally do not contact customers through text, email, or automated phone message about problems with an account. Police say you should always contact your bank directly rather than respond to a text or an unsolicited phone call. Back now in South Carolina, state lawmakers are dealing with the controversy of texting while driving. The Senate Judiciary Committee has approved a measure that would fine drivers $45 for doing that. The committee voted 15-3 in favor. The measure calls for a $20 fine plus a $25 state trauma care fund surcharge if the person is convicted. Texting behind the wheel is already a crime in the city of Clemson. Violators there are fined $200, and the police chief there believes the state ought to come up with a stiffer penalty than $45.
There are a lot of people that $45, they're not even going to think about that. And so even though our city ordinance cannot and does not assess points on the driver's license, it does have a pretty substantial fine assessment to it. And I think therein, you know, lies the teeth that we're talking about that causes people to think twice before they text or email.
The bill now goes on to the Senate floor.
Tonight there's proof that employees at Spartanburg's Mary Black Hospital have a really big heart. This was the view from Sky 4 as the staff joined up to form a big heart on the hospital's front lawn. To take part, employees bought a $15 t-shirt and a $5 pass, which allowed them to wear jeans to work. All of the proceeds go to the American Heart Association.
March 13th it is. Southwest Airlines comes winging in and out of GSP that day, and the airline is already busy getting ready for the big debut. News 4's Nigel Robertson tonight with an exclusive look behind the scenes.
The signs are everywhere, but this one at the check-in counter is by far the biggest.
Now all the passengers are going by looking at it and snapping photos, and they're real excited, and kind of the buzz is in the air now.
Southwest employees getting ready for the big day. The luggage carriers are here along with other ground equipment.
Just unpacking a bunch of stuff. We had about three semis that showed up about 2 weeks ago. Office supplies, office equipment.
And more is on the way. The airline gave us access to places where the public never gets to see. Yellow and canyon blue, not purple, are everywhere you look around gates A3 and A4. Future customers are excited.
We did the happy dance. A number of reasons. We were familiar with the airlines, and we were hoping for better prices.
And because of competition, those better prices will likely be the case, no matter what airline you fly. Nigel Robertson, WYFF News 4, Spartanburg County.
Another big step here. Tomorrow, bright and early, 40 Southwest Airlines employees will report for work on the first day on the job at GSP.
Distributors and pharmacists say they're seeing a shortage of a drug that's designed to help people with ADHD. News 4's Myra Ruiz joins us with more. And Myra, what's the reason for the shortage?
Carol, it depends on who you ask. We're hearing it's a combination of things that make it harder to keep up with the demand.
This is the generic of Adderall 20. Adderall is one of the drugs that's listed as being is an abuse drug.
Pharmacist Blair Tidmarsh says he does everything he can to make sure Adderall doesn't wind up in the wrong hands.
I don't want to supply drug addicts.
Especially when drug distributors say it's hard enough meeting the demands of those who really need it.
With the increased use, that's my opinion, is why you're running into some of these shortages.
An executive from an upstate distribution company says Adderall is highly regulated when it comes to both manufacturing and distributing the drug. He adds that there are fewer companies making generic versions, so overall it's getting harder to keep up with the demand.
There probably is a higher use of it than there used to be. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is more recognized now than it used to be. Then you're going to have children who might go untreated, and they're going to have a more difficult time in school and in the classroom. And children who have untreated attention deficit disorder are going to have a harder time with their learning, and they get behind in school and they have behavior problems.
One drug distributor says he expects the supply of Adderall to reach sufficient levels within 2 to 3 weeks. Carol?
Myra, thank you. Tonight, all new at 11, some South Carolinians with lung cancer have a new option when it comes to treatment. And a doctor in Spartanburg was the first in the state to successfully complete the procedure.
We've seen a significant improvement. You know, patients are staying probably a day or two less in the hospital. They're hurting less, and the recovery is much better.
But he doesn't work alone. A robot is part of the process. See one of his actual surgeries and find out how it differs from the traditional way. That's all new tonight at 11.
No storms. All is calm. All is cool. Especially John Cesarich, of course. Always cool.
I don't know about that. Yeah. But, you know, some pretty nice weather out there.
And
it'd be nice if it stayed around for a little bit longer.
But
it's not going to. Now, been talking about it for the last several days. We're going to have that northeasterly wind. Really, it's going to kick in. And it's going to get colder over the next several days. And then we could see a few patches of drizzle or light rain on Friday. I think we'll stay dry tomorrow. But that breeze out of the northeast will certainly make it feel much colder than the actual high temperatures in the upstate and northeastern Georgia. Otherwise, you can see on live Super Doppler 4 HD, everything is nice and quiet. We're going to stay dry tonight and tomorrow. Then we're looking at some mid to high level clouds moving quickly across our skies, as you can see, from the northwest to the southeast across the area. And at times we'll see these clouds. They'll thin out from time to time. They may get a little bit thicker from time to time. So you may see the stars dim as far as the light goes from time to time tonight. So basically clear to partly cloudy skies. And that's going to continue through tomorrow. Not bad. Temperatures mainly in the 60s across the area, except for 59 in Bristol. And in the deep south, it's currently 57 degrees in Wilmington. Everybody else is in the 60s. 58 right now in Asheville. It's currently 50 in Boone. 63 in Rutherfordton. It's 63 in Spartanburg, Anderson, also in Greenwood and in Gainesville and in Andrews. It's also 63 in Knoxville. So some pretty nice temperatures out there. Humidity levels remaining fairly low, as you can see. Only 27% in Nashville, only 34% humidity currently in downtown Greenville. So with mainly clear skies and very little wind, we have a southwest breeze at 9 miles per hour in Greenville, southwest at 7 in Spartanburg, and a northerly wind at 14 miles per hour in Asheville. So with the fairly dry air, a little bit of a breeze from time to time. In fact, that southwesterly wind's going to shift to northeast once this cold front passes by out of the northeast during the night tonight. 62 was the high today in Asheville, and 66 was the common number, at least so far. At 11 o'clock tonight, I'll update these numbers for you. A few spots could warm up to maybe 67, 68 degrees this afternoon. Look how cold it was this morning. 30 in Greenwood, 33 in Anderson, 36 in downtown Greenville, and right at the freezing mark this morning in Spartanburg, and upper 20s this morning at the Asheville Airport. There's the mid to high level clouds. Arctic air remaining up here in the northern plains, back into the northern Rockies, and that's where it's going to stay. So none of this cold air is going to move into the south, but a piece of this cold air is going to move into the northeast, where it's right at 39 degrees in Boston. And as that northeasterly wind kicks in, we're going to drive some of that unseasonably cold air to our north into the deep south. So warm front to our west. Here's the northeasterly wind. And even with mostly sunny to partly sunny skies tomorrow, that northeasterly wind is certainly going to make it feel much colder than the actual highs. And the only highs are only going to be in the 50s tomorrow. 32 for the overnight low in the mountains, 39 degrees in the upstate, clear to partly cloudy skies tomorrow. Mostly sunny to partly sunny skies in the mountains. Mostly sunny, but a chilly breeze out of the northeast developing during the day. Highs only in the upper 50s. And as I mentioned, that northeasterly wind is going to make it feel even much colder than the actual high. Even colder yet on Friday with overcast skies and a few patches of drizzle or light rain. High only 50 or 51 degrees. And then we start to warm up a little bit for the weekend. As a warm front passes by, another cold front comes in. Right now, there is still no indication as far as severe weather. If it comes in late Saturday night into Sunday morning, we'll probably just see thunder showers. So timing's very critical with these storm systems. But either way, it looks like a pretty good chance of showers and possible thundershowers over the weekend.
All kinds of fronts coming and going.
They're coming and going.
Going all over the place, and you're watching them all.
Yeah, I certainly am.
Thanks.